Good afternoon and welcome. I'm Deborah Jordy, Executive Director of the Scientific and Cultural Facilities District, and I'm joining you today from the Museo de las Americas. And behind me are these beautiful prints that are available for purchase through the museum. Just as we start, we'll be moving through our speakers briefly this afternoon and then take questions through the chat function at the end. I'm going to be speaking briefly today about the economic realities in the arts and cultural sector, as we are entering now our 8th month of various necessary public health orders to stem the pandemic. As you likely know, the district collects one penny in sales tax on every $10 spent in the 7-county Denver metro area. The money supports 300 arts, culture, and scientific organizations across the district and provides hundreds of free programming for individuals and families to experience the wonder and joy of our communities. As part of our voter-approved mission to support these organizations, we have launched two surveys on the realities during the pandemic shutdown. One in April, just after the stay-at-home order was put in place, and the second in September, 6 months into the national public health emergency. In total, 244 organizations we support responded to the survey in September, representing a large cross-section of arts, culture, and scientific nonprofit organizations in metro area. What we found is critical to the future of the curative sector, of the cultural sector. I want to give you a few top-line numbers, and the link to the full survey is in the chat function now. 80% responding said the financial impact of the pandemic had been moderate to extremely severe. 60% said their earned revenue, meaning revenue from performances, for example, was significant to near total loss. 33% or more of the 12,000 jobs represented by the survey respondents have been lost to furlough, layoffs, and elimination. That's 1/3 of the workforce. 48% of the organizations responded reported having 4 months or less of reserves available to continue operations. That number has dropped nearly to 60% in April. And 75% responding were only moderately confident and not confident at all that their organizations would survive the pandemic. That number is down from 88 in April. And down from 88 who were moderately confident that they would survive. These numbers give us a sense of the economic distress on our cultural community and signals the threat to our cultural sector. I might add at this time, it's a time to think about giving. And on December 8th, you can participate in Colorado Gives Day, where we can make arts and culture organizations a priority. It's now my pleasure to turn it over to Denver Arts and Venue Executive Director Ginger White Brunetti, who is joining us from the lobby of the Ellie Calkins Opera House at the Denver Performing Arts Complex. Thank you.
Thank you, Deborah. Good afternoon, everyone. As Deborah said, I'm joining you all from the lobby of the Ellie Calkins Opera House. Now, in a typical year, about this time, hundreds of little boys and girls would fill the seats. They'd be running around the lobby behind me or going to a holiday field trip, dressed in their best with their families to watch the Nutcracker. And just across the way down the Galleria, thousands more would fill the Buell Theater next door to discover once again whether the Grinch really will steal Christmas this time. And where I stand today doesn't just represent our beloved holiday traditions. It's also a reminder of the more than 3,500 actors, singers, musicians, artists, backstage crew, box office staff, and more who bring more than 2,700 performances to life each year at the Denver Performing Arts Complex. But these gatherings we hold so dear simply can't happen this year. Our public health demands this greater loyalty to one another to keep us safe and end this pandemic. So while we stay safer at home, we also know that our organizations and artists who bring us so much joy at this time of year and all times of year are also hurting. That's why I'm with you today to launch phase 2 of the Arts Through It All holiday campaign. This holiday public awareness campaign in the Denver metro area will make an appeal to support arts and culture at a time it is most needed. With a call of act to action of give, gift, shop, emphasizing the tagline of art from the heart, The campaign will remind all of us that to truly live local and support all that we love in our community, we need to make our arts and our cultural organizations a part of holiday giving. So here's how you can participate. You can give a donation to arts and cultural organizations or to an artist relief fund. You can gift a membership, a subscription, or a class, and you can shop, my favorite, local and support artists. So we know that the joy of watching a play or hearing live music or experiencing art or exploring science can bring. If we want to keep experiencing that joy, we need to do what we can to help our organizations that bring us joy to survive these difficult times. Now, the city of Denver has committed almost $1.5 million to support Denver's creative community. Furthermore, the Arts Through It All holiday campaign is being funded in part by the city of Denver's allocation of CARES Act coronavirus relief funds. In addition to the city of Denver, other sponsors of the campaign include PNC Bank, Adams County, Denver Arts and Venues, the city of Boulder, and the Bonfils-Stanton Foundation. We want to thank all of our sponsors who have made this campaign possible. So over the coming weeks, you'll be seeing and hearing the Arts Through It All Holidays campaign on television, radio, and through your social media feeds. It's my hope that when you do, you'll take a moment to act and to give a gift that will not only brighten someone's holiday, but will brighten the future of our arts community. And since today is Giving Tuesday, why not make a gift today? So now I'd like to turn it over to Ryan Beiser, Regional President and Head of Corporate Banking at PNC Bank, to talk about corporate support for the arts. Thanks, Ryan.
Thanks so much, Ginger. Happy to be here with all of you today on behalf of PNC Bank. Through PNC Bank's charitable support, we're focused on strengthening and enriching the lives of our neighbors and the communities where we live and work. The arts have long been a priority of PNC Bank's corporate philanthropy. And thus, when PNC Bank entered the Colorado market in 2018, we found it a priority to support what was a vibrant arts and culture scene. In fact, we found a way to marry two of our closest philanthropic efforts together, early childhood education and the arts. We've done this through support of the Children's Museum of Denver, Cleo Parker Robinson Dance, Think 360 Arts. Plus, of course, there's the Claude Monet Truth in Nature sponsorship that we were able to take part in earlier this year at our beloved Denver Art Museum. Broke a number of records, very meaningful to Denver arts and culture and the city's economy. We also were able this year to find a way to actually support the holidays. Although we can't go see the Nutcracker in person, this is my son's, we, in partnership with the Colorado Ballet, were able to bring this virtual support of Rocky Mountain PBS and have it on TV for all Coloradans to be able to enjoy during the holidays. As a bank, we understand the value that arts and culture bring to the economy. In the Denver metro area alone, 12,000 jobs are created and sustained on an annual basis through arts and culture. Based on the most recent 2018 Colorado Business Committee for the Arts survey, found that the creative sector contributes $573 million to our local economy. If you add to that lodging, dining, that goes to $1.9 billion, billion with a B. That's why I'm here to urge the business community to join PNC Bank in support of arts and culture over this holiday season, finding ways through giving, through gifting, and through shopping to support the sector. Now I'd like to turn it over to Tony Ortega, a local Colorado artist, both a Governor's and Mayor's Award for Excellence in the Arts, nationally recognized painter and visual artist, On a side note, we're going to open our first branch here in Denver in January, and we were able to purchase two of Tony's pieces to deck the walls of that new location. Tony, without further ado, I'll turn it over to you.
Thank you, Ryan. I've been asked to speak briefly today from the perspective of a working artist. In fact, I've been doing that for 36 years. COVID and its effect on the economy have reminded me of my own vulnerability. This is a turbulent period of social distancing, isolation, quarantine, cancellation, and closures that are having an immense impact on our art community. Like many other artists, all of my exhibits have been postponed, canceled, or closed to the public, and all my classes are online. I understand that we must keep our families, colleagues, students, and everyone safe and healthy, but COVID has created a hardship in the art community. Not only am I a working artist, but I'm a professor at Regis University. And in mid-March, I had to hit the ground running. I was teaching three classes, two studio courses, and one lecture course. I had very little training teaching remotely. It was good that I had started the semester with all these students, and they rallied and stayed engaged in finishing their schoolwork and classes. It is very challenging teaching online. I teach three levels of painting. It's a very tactile medium. Students get messy. Everyone touches paint, brushes, water, and canvases. You can't share this online with them. Try doing a studio demo with no experience. But I've learned to adapt and be flexible during the semester. Back in March, I had artwork in several exhibits that were part of the citywide celebration of the month of printmaking. One print exhibit, Estampas Comunes Corrientes at the Chicano Humanities and Arts Council, that I curated and organized, was of Latino artists from work around the country. We had a wonderful opening with a few sales. The exhibit was canceled 1 week into the scheduled run. No more visitors, no classroom visits, and no workshops. The second exhibition was at the William Havu Gallery of my prints on the mezzanine. I was lucky since there was an opening on March 6th and we had a few sales. The exhibit was closed, much like others in the area. It reopened in June, but there were very few visitors and no more sales. I currently have an exhibit at the Longmont Museum in celebration of their 20th anniversary of Day of the Dead. There was a virtual opening on October 1st, and since there have been a limited amount of visitors, no classroom visits from local students like in years past. I have also have an exhibit at the new galleries at the Denver Botanic Gardens. The original opening date was November 5th, but that was pushed back because of COVID. It was rescheduled to open a week and a half ago on Saturday, November 21st, but because of current restrictions, no one can visit the exhibit. So I join everyone speaking today in urging all of us to keep the arts in our holiday, giving even as we miss so many of our holiday arts traditions. We need our arts organizations strong and healthy for next year, and that simply won't happen without your help. If you can give, why not consider making a charitable donation to many of your favorite art nonprofits, theater, or museum? There are many local exhibitions online, such as the holiday exhibit at the Arvada Center for the Arts and Humanities. I encourage everyone to support local artists and purchase a work of art from them. Now I'd like to turn it over to someone who really does not need my introduction at all, an internationally known dancer, choreographer, and true Denver treasure, Cleo Parker Robinson.
Thank you, Tony. Thank you, and thank you to this amazing team for your leadership in this effort. For those of us struggling to keep our organizations alive and healthy, it really helps to know that you are all with us. You can see behind me that our theater is under major reconstruction, and more than half of it is dismantled at this time. Usually this time of year, we're presenting a dozen live performances of Granny Dances to a Holiday Drum. This year, our 29th season of Granny is completely virtual. And I'll talk about that a little bit more later. But I can honestly say, like many of you, that I have never quite seen a year like this one. And it's our 50th anniversary, and I know about strange years. The very last event we had here in our theater was when Governor Polis signed the Crown Act in early March, the night before our COVID shutdown began. We were also to premiere a work at Jacob's Pillow after a gap of 10 years. And at the L.A. Calkins, we were going to premiere our new work with the National Ballet de Mexico. We're doing what we can and how we can and as much as we can to keep doing the work we've been doing for over 50 years. This year, Cleo Parker Robinson Dance is celebrating the 50 years of We Hope Excellence. Since 1970, we've been working to unite our community around the beauty and importance of dance and all of the arts. As I mentioned earlier this year, for the first time, we'll be offering an annual Denver-grown holiday tradition, Granny Dances to a Holiday Drum, all virtual. While we're sad that we won't have live audiences, the blessing is we can share this global cultural performance with audiences around the globe. We quickly pivoted in March so that our academy instruction classes for dancers of all ages moved online. During the summer, we were able to hold classes outdoors and be socially distanced. But now again, as the weather is changing and getting colder, we are following COVID protocols and we are virtually performing and teaching. We continue to monitor protocols daily for safety for everyone in our organization and our students. Companies like PNC have helped us to take our programs to students in Denver, around Colorado, and around the US with remote learning. Comcast and AT&T brought in resources to strengthen our tech background and the tech STEM program that we do right here. We rely more on virtual production and the staffing to keep it all going. Now we have over 20 groups that use our theater regularly to do their work and present their work right here. Our dancers and staff are family. Fortunately, through creativity and technology, we've been able to keep everyone employed through virtual programming. But many arts and cultural organizations, large and small, haven't been able to do that and are not as fortunate. And this is why we, our entire community, choose art as a gift, now more than ever. We believe that the arts do make a difference. During the pandemic, this has become evident as we rely virtual and broadcasting entertainment by artists of all backgrounds. Our Denver arts community is a part of what keeps us connected. Even though we miss being together with in-person art events, make your home a cultural haven. When you buy tickets to a virtual performance, when you buy a membership or you prescribe, it keeps our precious arts alive and our artists working. What's on your dance card for the holidays? Make your arts from the heart, art from the heart, a cultural experience in many forms. Each of you can make a difference to keep us in mind during the holiday gift giving by giving tickets, annual pass, membership, subscriptions, and giving you and your household the gift of art and culture. I hope you'll remember to give some art from the heart this holiday season. And we thank each of you. Happy holidays.
Thank you so much, Cleo, and thank you, Tony. I feel like we owe you a standing ovation for your resiliency, your adaptability, and your passion for arts, and your passion for Denver and our broad community. So hearing what you all have done and how you've pivoted, my least favorite word of 2020 is really remarkable, and we're all better for it. So as we close the speaking portion of the press conference, we'd like to take a minute to show you how the campaign will look and feel to the public. I'll note for you that a link to the full campaign is in the chat, which you'll see in a second, and will also be provided in the press materials that we're going to be sending to you following the press conference. So here's my favorite. It's an example of the campaign that you'll see on a billboard around town shortly. Again, the gift of arts from the heart, encouraging people to give, gift, and shop. And then the next image we're going to show you is an example of the larger call to action for everyone, which you will see in print media. And again, this is encouraging people to give a donation to local arts and cultural organizations or relief funds, to gift a membership or a subscription or a class to your favorite cultural organization, and again, to shop and support our local artists. And that includes going to our museum shops, galleries, your favorite creative district shop to find those artists around town. So now I would like to open it up for questions. You are invited to please put any questions in the chat, and I will serve as your moderator and direct your questions to one of our speakers. But while we're giving you some time to type and populate the chat with your questions, I'd like to make sure you know an answer to hopefully a question that's at the top of your mind, which is, where can I go to find out where to give, gift, and shop? Well, we have thought of that, and we have created, with the help of Colorado Business Committee for the Arts, who's really been the champion behind all of this effort, is a new website called artsthroughitall.org. And there you can find several ways to shop, give, and just connect with cultural organizations that you love. So with that, I'm gonna see if there are any questions in the chat. And let's see, currently I'm not seeing any. So if you do, feel free to go ahead and type those in. Perhaps we did a great job of tugging on your heartstrings already, which I hope is the case. So let me ask, I'll ask this of Deborah. What is your favorite part of this campaign, Deborah?
Well, like you, Ginger, I love to shop. So I will be going to museum gift store, gift shops, but also one of my all-time favorite is I'm getting my grandson ukulele lessons at Swallow the Music for the holidays. But there are endless opportunities. The other piece I think I would say is, given that it's International Gives Day and Colorado Gives Day, we can all dig a little deeper in support of our organizations this year. And so many of the organizations have independent fundraising campaigns. So this is a great way just to amplify the message of what they're doing.
Great. Thank you. And I would encourage people to go to the website artsthroughitall.org, because there are some really great ideas, some hidden gems around the metro area that you can find to support either through a donation or to shop, or as Deborah is doing, to purchase an online class. I think we all, for those of us who have small kids at home, are always looking for ways to engage and entertain and not just on YouTube. So it's a great alternative for this holidays. Let's see, we have another. So Cleo, can you remind us how you can participate in Granny Dances to a Holiday Drum this year?
You know, I'd love to. I'd love it. You know, I've danced in it for 29 years, so I'm not so sure. This might be the last time they see me do Granny, but we go online to Cleo ParkerDance.org, and you know, just go to our website. And what's wonderful is people really are going online and creating a time that their whole family can watch Granny. But we have a period of time. It'll open on the 5th. It'll go through January 4th. We've never gone through Christmas time. So what's wonderful is I find that people can think about their own traditions. It should just inspire them to do more with each other. And it's such a time for potential of celebrating and buying art. And I'm the best gift shopper ever. I go into I love art galleries that just inspire you. And it makes me want to dance when I go through them. I mean, I'm dancing galleries. There's so much that can be done this time to really help artists, musicians and dancers and writers and painters. And so good to see Tony. I haven't seen him in a while. I loved looking at his gallery. And, you know, it's just there's so much that can happen. And I think we need our spirit lifted. Everybody needs that uplifting spirit. And, you know, I have my grandbaby dancing in Granny. And I was like, I don't get to see her all the time. And I go, but I get to see her in Granny. I get to see her on the tape. So it's very exciting. Thank you.
Thank you, Cleo. We had another question in the chat, which is, what is the geographic footprint for the campaign? Well, we are, and through the help of CBCA, Colorado Business Committee for the Arts, there are media buys that are happening in print, radio, and TV, largely in the Metro Denver area, including Adams County and Boulder County. But the beauty of this campaign is the toolkit that is on the website can be downloaded, and we encourage arts organizations, jurisdictions, municipalities, statewide to utilize the assets that we've created and make them your own and help us amplify the arts across Colorado. So certainly you'll see these things largely in the Front Range part of our state, but that doesn't prohibit anyone from going out and utilizing these assets and the collateral to your advantage across the state. And so, Tony, can you tell us about the two artworks that will be in PNC's bank in their new downtown branch?
Sure, I'd like to share that with you. Yeah, I work in a variety of media. The two pieces that they are purchasing are monotypes, and monotypes are a one-of-a-kind print. Actually, it's more of a painting than a print, but it's a work on paper. I've been working on monotypes for well over 30 years now. They're 22 by 30. They're images of what I call genre scenes. They're scenes of everyday life. So I'm informed by my neighborhood, my community, the state, the Southwest, et cetera. And I bring images or drawings or photographs to my studio. So one is an image of some boys as they're sitting in the back in their backyard, resting from playing some soccer. So again, they're about gathering places. They're about community, about people coming together to do a variety of activities. And the second image is actually students at North High School here on the north side in Denver. And they're just outside of their one of their ball fields. So these two pieces will be part of the PNC Bank collection.
Thanks so much, Tony. We can't wait to see it in person when we're able to get back out and about. So, and thank you, Ryan, for your leadership and making that commission possible. So we're going to close out our press conference today, seeing no more questions in the chat. But I want to thank you all for being here and being with us this afternoon. Again, we'll be sending out press materials, including a full copy of the SCFD survey data that Deborah shared with us earlier, as well as a link to the assets in this campaign. We've also dropped contact information into the chat if you have additional needs or follow-up questions. And also in the chat is a link to the toolkit at the artsthroughitall.org website. I want to thank my fellow speakers for your time today and your commitment to arts and culture across our city and beyond, and wish everybody a happy holiday. And please don't forget to give, gift, and shop so that our arts can endure. Thank you.